It's rough out there, you know, in the world. Some of us turn to writing for solace and inspiration. Text that helps us take in the dark and find the light. So if you are someone who wraps themselves in words to warm your heart, or maybe just looking for a little help getting through the day, week, year, join us as we talk to people about the pieces of writing they use to bolster their souls and remember their way. The good bones that remind us we can make this place beautiful. Hello, and welcome to a very special episode of Finding Good Bones, a podcast that examines the writing that helps us sit with the dark and look to the light. Today is November 6th, 2024, the day after the American election. So we are processing a lot of the sitting with the dark. You know, I have, I'm your host, one of your hosts, Kate Caldwell, and I am here with our other host, Amy. And yeah, we thought, you know, if maybe some other people are feeling away right now that we are or similar to, then this could be, I don't know, just a thing to listen to. Helpful, not helpful, but, you know, a thing, a tool potentially for your toolbox of sitting with the dark and working a way to find the light. Hey, Amy. I am.
Hey, how are you?
Full stop. I am. How are you?
I am okay.
That's awesome.
I'm being okay.
Dear listeners, you might hear some strange audio on my side. I decided this morning that I would keep my toddler home with me for snuggles and stern dressing downs. Obviously, her dressing me down for not doing something specifically the way she would like me to, albeit she has not quite explained it to me, but it's fine. So she's running around. Like I said, this is a very special, slightly unplanned episode. So yeah, so we're rolling with it. Mm-hmm. With, like so many things, mm-hmm. we're rolling with it. So I have brought two kind of juxtaposing, poems that I love and that honestly I was planning on doing someday for us anyway. We're going to skip our intro bit and really just get into it. So I'll just read them both. The first one is the poem Hope by Emily Dickinson. Hope is the thing with feathers that perches in the soul and sings the tune without words and never stops at all. And sweetest in the gale is heard, and sore must be the storm that could abash the little bird that kept so many warm. I've heard it in the chillest land and on the strangest sea, yet never in extremity it asked a crumb of me. And then the next poem is entitled, Hope is Not a Bird, Emily, It's a Sewer Rat, by Caitlin Saida. I'll have to double check on the pronunciation of Caitlin's name. You got two lollipops?
Uh-huh.
Definitely didn't.
Got two lollipops.
In life? Yeah, you did get two lollipops in life. Hope is not the thing with feathers that comes home to roost when you need it most. Hope is an ugly thing with teeth and claws and patchy fur that's seen some shit. It's what thrives in the discards and survives in the ugliest parts of our world, able to find a way to go on when nothing else can even find a way in. It's the gritty, nasty little carrier of such diseases as optimism, persistence, perseverance, and joy, transmissible as it drags its tail across your path and bites you in the ass. Hope is not some delicate, beautiful bird, Emily. It's a lowly little sewer rat that snorts pesticides like they were lines of coke and still shows up on time to work the next day, looking no worse for the wear. I love both of these poems in their own right.
I love
right.
both of them.
And I love both of these concepts yeah. of hope. I love yeah. the idea that hope is something that is listening, right? Like a little bird, a little friend that's like, oh, do you need me?
Uh-huh.
Is this my hour, right? Like, oh, you know, it's a very fairy godmother type of hope, right? And what I love about Emily's mm-hmm. poem is mm-hmm. that hope comes to everybody, right? Like, it's not just her. She's not like, this is my experience. She's mm-hmm. like, hope does this for everybody. And I love a lot about it. Like, I just love the line, hope is the thing with feathers. I mean, she doesn't really say that it's a bird, but no, she does. But just this idea that it's this kind of little floating entity that flies around, yeah, wherever it's needed most. It's also kind of like Pete's dragon, if you remember that. He goes to mm-hmm. those mm-hmm. kids that need him and helps them feel safe and warm.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah. You're right. I love both these poems. the second one, it feels like yeah. it was just written for me. Not even right now, oh, but yeah. always. No, I've seen this one many times, and I was really happy to have you bring it to me today.
It does.
Because it fits.
Both of those concepts. Yeah, it fits really well. I have hope in both of those ways. I have had hope visit me, yeah. perch on a tree, sing sweetly, and brighten my day. And I have had hope claw its way in when I didn't want it, squeeze in, infect me with seeing a possibility, seeing a path forward, when really all I wanted to do was sit mm-hmm. and dwell. And I will be honest, yeah. every time I think about also the title of this poem constantly, that's one of my favorite parts. There's so much to love about this poem from the visualization. And I do see Pizza Rat. I don't know if.
Yeah. Pizza Rat is I thought of Pizza uh-huh. Rat there at the end, of course. Pesticides. Like, they're aligned, little sewer rat snorting pesticides. Absolutely. Who cannot think of Pizza Rat? Pizza Rat came to us into the world for, I don't want to say a reason, because I don't believe in things happening for a reason, but Pizza Rat is a perfect image for so much that happens.
Look, Pizza Rat is not only surviving, but working on thriving. Right?
Yeah.
I don't think that things happen for a reason, but I do think that when we choose, we can find reason in things that happen. We are also allowed to not choose to try to do that, right? I think it's looking at it as a choice. Yes. It helps some people to look at something and try to find a lesson or a reason or something to take from it. And I think it also helps people to acknowledge that there was no reason why this happened, but it did change them, right? Like, this was absurd and random and there's no reason for it. But here is what I can take from it.
I love the way that you look at things like that and help me look at them like that, because all I do when someone says everything happens for a reason is imagine right. my fist in their
and
face.
And then you'd be like, well,
because people will say that
happened for a reason after you punch them.
Yeah, exactly. I mean, people will say that at the worst possible time, someone dies or something, and they'll be like, everything happens for a reason. And I'll be like, I don't believe.
Yeah, sure.
This,
death
and what you're saying is not helpful.
It's called mortality.
Yeah.
No,
but,
there's no,
you know,
there's
a
no
child
reason,
dies,
like, there's
or,
no,
you know, like.
There's a greater purpose. Don't believe that it has happened to serve a greater purpose for somebody else. This is very much when you get into, like, the BS characters, right? Like, fridged. women. I think the magical Negro is a term that gets used a lot as well. But like, characters, mm-hmm. it's this very like main character energy concept that assumes that the people around us are plot lines that exist, subplot lines that exist to serve our own. And everybody's a main character. Everybody is a main character. I think there are ways that can capture the aftermath of a death, of an illness, of whatever, right? Like of whatever kind of loss it is or whatever kind of pain it is. Like it does change mm-hmm. people, and that's mm-hmm. important to acknowledge, because there can also be on the flip side something terrible happens. And, you know, the mm-hmm. same people sometimes that are like, everything happens for a reason are also like, well, it happened. Got to move forward exactly the same. Right. And it's like, oh, no, everything that happened changes. Right. It changes something. But it's not. No, your child did not die so that you would learn a lesson neatly wrapped in a bow. My dad, I think about that sometimes. Yeah. Like, my dad didn't go crazy so that I would become a better person. Did that result from that experience? I think so. But it's not why it happened. He deserves more credit for that or than that, you know?
Yes.
And so I love the idea. I love Emily's idea of hope flying around and, you know, being there to boost people. And it's not that she's also talking about it. Like, it is just, you know, making a mediocre day better, right? Like, she is saying, you know, in the chillest land mm-hmm. and the strangest sea, right? Those aren't great places.
Yeah.
And I do love that she that she ends with, it's never, hope has never asked me to hope. And I do agree with that, right?
Yeah.
Hope presents itself as an option and can remind you that it's there. And in both of these ways, again, right? Like in the very sweet, like, tune without words, and then also biting you in the ass. Yeah.
Love it. I mean, and seriously.
Oh, no, it's just, it's what.
No, go ahead.
It's what thrives in the discards, right? I don't know how much hope is necessary for people that get everything they want. You know what I mean? And I know, like, not everybody gets, quote unquote, everything that they want. But there are people in this world that get a lot more. Yeah.
I haven't been reading beautiful poems that sum up an entire, I don't know what to call it. I don't want to say a way of thinking, but sum up an entire way of looking at the world today. But I have been thinking through some of my favorite quotes from Guess Who, Terry Pratchett. Because his characters, the two that I love the most are Sam Vimes and Granny Weatherwax. And both of them have the reason I love them is because they both have a specific approach to the world. And that is that they are grumbly people who look to the world like they're just grumpy and hate everything. But inside, they are the most solid moral people. And one of the lines that is from Night Watch, which is one of my favorite books, is not, it's not even a deep line or a beautiful line, but it says privilege, which just means private law. Two types of people laugh at the law, those that break it and those that make it. And I've been thinking about that little passage, those little sentences all day today. And then, I hear Eleanor. And then some stuff from Granny Weatherwax. One of them is from the book that I read a piece from, Carpe Jugulum. But this is again, I'm just reading sentences. This is, and sin, young man, is when you treat people like things.
Yeah, that's beautiful. Yeah. No, I agree. They're both incredibly grumpy people, and they are also the people that you can trust to show up and help.
Absolutely,
and do
to show
whatever
up.
They can
yeah.
to help. They will complain about
yeah.
it. And I think that that's hope in both of these poems, too. You can trust hope to show mm-hmm. up whether you want it or not. You can trust hope to be there if you are in a place where you're looking for it, Emily Dickinson style, right? It's the thing with feathers. If you are
yeah.
not, if you don't want it, mm-hmm. but, you know, it's still there because it is. I think that then it's the sewer rat that's living with you in the trash,
yeah.
right? In the gutter.
Yeah. I don't know. We were talking before we started recording about the concept of hope. And right now I was struggling with hope. I am struggling with hope, but I'm also now coming to the Terry Pratchett way of looking at things, which is grubby,
oh, yeah.
like what you're talking about with hope. I have another passage
yes.
I want to read from Carpe Jugum.
I have a Terry Pratchett
if you don't
that
mind.
I want to read in a moment.
It's
yeah.
Okay. Oh, awesome. Awesome. So this is another couple of sentences
okay,
from Carpe Jugum.
Molly.
It's Granny Weatherwax. So remember, Granny Weatherwax is a witch, and she's talking to a representative of a religion that in the past has done some bad things to witches. So she says, "You say that you people don't burn folk and sacrifice people anymore. But that's what true faith means, you see. Sacrificing your own life one day at a time to the flame, declaring the truth of it, working for it, breathing the soul of it. That's religion. Anything else is just being nice and a way of keeping in touch with the neighbors."
So I really love to talk about all the time to anybody that ever calls me nice, the distinction between nice and kind. I am not a
yeah.
nice person, and I don't mean
yeah.
that disparagingly against myself. I am a kind person. I do think that there is such a huge difference between nice and kind, and I think appearances have so much to do with that. Keeping in touch with the neighbors, right? Nice is,
mm-hmm,
you know,
mm-hmm.
saying placating things. Nice and kind can certainly overlap, right? But I think that nice is about
mm-hmm.
keeping the status quo, even when it's not good. Nice is,
yeah,
smoothing things over that deserve to be disturbed, right? I think
mm-hmm,
that nice
mm-hmm.
is lawful evil. And I think
yeah.
kind is chaotic
yeah.
good.
I want just
yeah.
or also like all of the good
can
and all of the neutral.
Sesame Street?
No, not right now, baby.
I want to watch Sesame Street.
I hear you. I want to watch Sesame Street too, but we got another thing that we're doing.
Thank you.
Well, where are we going to go?
But I want to watch Sesame Street.
You want to watch Sesame Street?
Twinkle, twinkle, little star. How I wonder what you are. At the world so high. Like a diamond. In the sky, twinkle, twinkle, little star, how I wonder what you are.
A dream
yes.
is a wish your
That's
heart
beautiful.
Makes when you're
yes.
fast asleep. In dreams, you can lose your heartache. Whatever you wish for, you keep. Have faith in your dreams and someday your rainbow will come. Oh, smiling through.
Hello.
No matter.
Hello.
How your heart is grieving. If you keep on believing the dream that you wish will come true. Okay. Mama's turn. Just a nice instrumental break right there.
This is really helping me thinking about Sam Vimes and Granny Weatherwax, who again both have the same attitude toward the world for their own particular reasons, is actually helping me right now. I've got one more thing from Carpe Jugulum. And it is Granny's whole matriarchal line. Have always been witches, and so the Weatherwax women. And so this is the Weatherwax women have always had one foot in shadow. It's in the blood, and most of their power comes from denying it.
I do love that.
That.
I think
good,
it
right?
goes back to, in some ways, you know, the themes that are tied together that influenced us in making this podcast, right? That there, it is always one foot in shadow. It is always one foot in light. Mm-hmm. And sometimes it's not a 50-50 split, right? A lot of times it's going back and forth between the two, but they're always present. They have to be. And maybe, you know, I wouldn't say I have hope that like everything is going to be great with no bumps and, you know, all of that. It's just more, I think that there are a lot of things that haven't been addressed or that have been smoothed over when they should have been left disrupted in our country, that we're just not going to have any choice but some sort of reckoning, right? And that can look like a lot of different things, but it's going to be a reckoning. And I think just having the understanding of that helps me. It's the sewer rat. Right? It's the sewer rat kind of hope that I have. It's for a someday better world.
I'm going to tell you one more thing. There's a line from Granny Weatherwax that always says there will be a reckoning.
I feel very intrinsically tied to Granny Weatherwax. I'm not gonna lie. There's so much about her. And I thought about her in an episode. Yeah. I think it'll come later. But where one grandmother replaces the next or steps up to the next, like fills in the role, and I just think about the maiden mother and crone. And
yep.
Yeah.
Maiden, mother, and crone.
Filling all the roles.
Love that. I've never known where I belong, so I'll just, since I'm not a maiden, not a mother, I guess I'm getting toward being a crone.
But I think we're
I
all
like
them,
filling all
right?
those roles at the same time.
I've never.
Yeah.
They are seasons in life, they are parts of our inner workings, right? I don't think that they're necessarily defined by age or by motherhood. I think that certainly you were a very maternal force for your cat who you kept alive against all odds for a very long time. You know, I think there's also, I was talking with a friend who is an artist, is a very creative person. And she was talking about how I was a literal mother. And I was like, no, look. You create, you bring things to life and you nurture them and you see them through. Yeah. And that is being a mother.
Yeah. The times I've been most a mother, I think, were the times when I was a Krav Maga instructor and everyone called me Fight Mom because I was the one who would see the people struggling and be like, I'm here.
I'm helping. Yeah.
Those are the times that, I'm helping you. I'm here for you. You're safe with me.
Like that, wasn't born out of Krav Maga, Amy. That was what you brought to Krav Maga. I know wherever you are and whoever you're working with, you are noticing when they are struggling and doing everything that you can to help them through it.
We both also do that. We give that to each other sometimes.
I love you.
Yeah.
I love you a whole lot. And I'm glad that we decided to take a little bit of time, whether anybody listens to it.
And I think it's fitting that there's a child screaming in the background, actually. I'm not kidding.
Well,
I really do.
She's messy.
I really do think that.
Hope,
she's messy.
Hope is also
and that's
a toddler. Wild and wailing one minute, soft and needy the next. Hope is also a toddler. I think that's a good note to end this on. Thank you so much, dear listeners. I hope that if you have been feeling away and choose to listen to this, this has either helped you feel more that way or in a different way, if that is what you were looking for. We hope that you continue to join us as we go finding good bones.